The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined on this journey interviewing everyone in Scotland revolving wrestling. I am joined with Reckless Tent's Chief of Staff, former UK and Hardcore Champion, the best Polish wrestler in Reckless Intent Wrestling. That's a guarantee. It's Jarek Nowak. Welcome to the show.
Hello, everyone. Yeah, also I should also add to my resume as the best Polish wrestler in Discovery Wrestling, and best Polish wrestler in Source Wrestling, and soon this is going to probably expand to like by other few promotions, but yep.
You put on CV as long as it's accurate, I mean,
yeah,
be as well. So welcome to the show. I've got first question to ask everyone. It's just the bog standard interview question. Yep. When it comes to wrestling. How did you get into pro wrestling? What was the moment when you were watching it that got you hooked on wrestling?
Oh man, yeah. As you know, I grew from Poland, and when I was growing up, there wasn't like much wrestling in Poland aside from like maybe one episode of a Polish TV show, which is like basically that TV show was basically like a combination with Married with Children and Ed and Eddie, which is like a sitcom with the people trying to basically scam people. And in one episode, they was trying to do like the underground wrestling league, as silly as it sounds. Yeah, basically they tried to like one of their neighbors, which is like very very big and heavy, they tried to put up against the other people that they found on the street. However, the problem was that these people were either unhealthy, or in one case one person was literally 20 kilograms, and but in the end he lost and the people decide to steal his TV and stuff like that. But yeah, I really enjoyed that episode and really hooked me into the wrestling stuff. However, this time, there was like much wrestling. But however, a few years later, there was like TNA decided to air in Poland on Eurosports channel. Not sure if you know this channel in UK or not.
But yeah, Eurosport, we used to have it way back when. So a long time ago.
Yeah, there were like the very first Impact episodes from like the Orlando, Florida studio. And I think there was the times where like we got guys like Team Canada, Alex Skipper, Chris Daniels, AJ Styles, and people like that. It really, really got me hooked into it. And they were like releasing like 2 or 3 episodes per week, I believe. However, at one point, they just keep repeating the same pay-per-view, which was like, I think it was Turning Point 2006. Right. And let's face it, it was a good pay-per-view, but I kind of got sick of watching the Voodoo Kin Mafia doing a parody promo of Spirit Squad at DX and challenging them at the Alamo.
Oh, yeah. That's amazing. Yeah. I'm just getting the card in front of me now because when you said Turning Point, the first one always comes in 2004 because that was my first one. Oh, wow. Okay. Yeah. Yes. Got bikini contest, Eric Young versus Miss Brooks. Oh.
Yes. That sounds like TNA by David Russo.
There's some good stuff on there. There's, of course, Samoa Joe, Kurt Angle.
Yeah.
Can't go wrong with that. And Abyss, Sting, Christian. Yeah, I'm now that I'm reading this, I remember this pay-per-view, unfortunately, including Eric Young versus Miss Brooks.
Come on, nothing embarrassing about Aaron Keogh. You don't like the SpongeBob's underpants?
That was a very interesting time. I think at some point, one of them got, I think Eddie Gunn got tarred and feathered. It was, yeah, so Turning Point 2006 is not one of your favorite pay per views now.
Not anymore, because I have to like keep watching it over and over and over again. And to this point, it got me kind of sick of wrestling, however. However, at the new station in Poland called Extreme Sports Channel, and no, I'm not joking, that was the real name of the channel, they started like publishing like a short episode of WWE Raw, which was like, I think it was like a month delayed. However, it got me hooked me back into wrestling and stuff, which guys like Cena, Batista, Shelton Benjamin, pretty much all the guys like that. And soon after that, they'll be posting SmackDown, ECW, NXT, and stuff like that. And got kind of put me back in the wrestling mind and, you know, kind of make me want to watch more and more of it.
So into early 2000, late 2000, that kind of middle point, mid 2000. Yeah. That's probably a better way to put it. So pretty good time to get into it. Did you ever ever have a thought when you were in Poland that you were going to pursue it yourself, or was that just a case of I like watching it and that's the end of the matter?
Yeah, I was like considering like trying to become the wrestler. However, during this time in Poland, there was like nobody wrestling schools or. Not to, for that matter. I think the first one that was like created was like in when I left Poland, and it was like in the middle of Warsaw, which is like way, way far away from my home city of Sopot, Poland.
So, I mean, I wouldn't take it personally that they set up after you left, but so what eventually brought you over here then and to Scotland?
Well, many reasons, but specifically financial situations, because let's face it, economy in Poland wasn't the greatest, especially for my family. So we came to like to the UK, Scotland, which was like, let's say, much more better than situation in Poland, because as you see in this room, yeah, pretty much like I have to like live with the same room with my dad and brother, and it wasn't the greatest, which is kind of like makes me happy that I can now live in my own room and have my own personal space as well.
So just a bit more opportunity and being able to have a life. Yeah. How long was it before you came over here then was it Livingston that you came to and saw Reckless Intent? How did you end up making that leap then from coming over and then finding a wrestling school?
Yeah, I think I came to Poland to Scotland in 2008. And I was trying to finish like schools and university stuff. And while I was like in the middle of university, I think it was like 2015, September to be exact, I was starting to look like for the wrestling schools around me. And the first one that caught my eye was Reckless Intent. So I decided to like message the page and ask if I could join them for training. And later, I was found out like a few years later by Mikey Michael Chase, like the former owner by the time, that he kind of ignored my message because he thought I was like a mark. Because at the time, on my Facebook, I had like a profile picture of Finn Balor with a bow tie, and that didn't really give him a best first impression of me.
Yeah. I could see that as well. Yeah, they probably saw it and just went, oh, this is either a spam account or just... A 12-year-old trying to be
kind of thing. Yep.
So outside of wrestling, then it sounds like you're always fairly interested in pursuing it. Did you do much sports or anything like that kind of gave you the foundation for pursuing wrestling? I ask a lot of people to do a martial art because that's kind of your replacement for wrestling. You still get to do it, but not get to do it. Yep. Was there anything like that you had going on?
Yeah, I think I did like a little rugby back in when I was in a primary school in Poland, but I quit it because most of my teammates were like, you know, not the greatest human beings, to say the most polite way. Right. And also I was like mostly the reserve anyway, and I wouldn't like do much on that.
Okay. But that was your kind of sporting background there, a bit rugby.
Yeah. Yeah, a bit of rugby.
Well, so, I mean, in that way, then, when it comes to transferring it to wrestling, that's, even though you weren't playing as often as you probably would have wanted to, then that gives you a little bit of stamina. I mean, you can get hit, and you're fairly okay with that as much as possible. So once you convinced Mikey that you're... I'm going to do the same now. Michael Chase, that you weren't some oddball I just wanted to be a wrestling mark. When you got to get to training then, what was that like? Do you remember what your first couple of days training were like?
I remember like that the first time I arrived to Reckless was, I think it was like during the 2015 Reckless Rumble. And Michael Chase told me, like, to other people that saying that I would not like last the week or the month. So yeah, that was a good start, I guess. Soon. And training wise, let's just be honest, I was the greatest. Yeah, I struggled with like the rows. I struggled with the stamina. I was like very, very sore at the very first day. And I was like literally limping when I was going to university.
So Michael didn't think you could cut it. Was that pretty much? Or yeah. You think it was a bit more tough love as the years went on, that he was maybe trying to push you a little bit more, or he just didn't like you at the time?
No, I don't think he had like much faith in me in the first place. However, luckily, I think during the Rampage Brown seminar, like 2 months later, I had like my very first practice match, and Mikey was like actually very impressed with me. He actually started to grow on with me a little bit more, and we soon after that became like very good pals as well. So that's a positive, at least.
Well, we'll say it was tough love then, because it makes it sound better. he was pushing you. So so when it came to, so you said you searched up, you found Reckless Intent in 2015. Mm-hmm. What was your kind of experience with British wrestling? Because you said you had a seminar with Rampage Brown, and that's a pretty big name in the UK wrestling scene, especially. Mm-hmm. Did you go to shows in and around? Did you see Reckless before you joined, messaged to join up? Did you go to any other wrestling shows in the area before that?
I think like the Reckless was like the very first show I saw live, and I was actually being person in there, because I was like doing the research before trying to find like other wrestling schools, but most of them were like far away in Glasgow or in the other cities, and I didn't like have like much vehicles or cars to like travel through it, so I decided to went with Reckless Intent, which is like the closest to me. And for luckily, Rob Mills, the other wrestling Reckless Intent, lives actually nearby me, and I end up traveling with him to the training. So that's a good story.
So I mean, yeah, especially if you're not 100% whether you want to do it or not, it's better to, I suppose it's better to get to a closer school, and then you can kind of, if you think, oh, this is for me, you can kind of go out a little bit, because I know she wrestled for Source, so she maybe did a couple sessions there at least with Rob as well.
I think I did with like to a few seminars, one with Billy Gunn and one with Chris Hero, which was pretty fun.
As someone who grew up then watching Billy Gunn, would have been out just as you started watching. But if you had things like the Eurosperm TNA, assuming you probably would have picked up some Chris Hero matches here and there.
I mean, I think Bill Gunn was in TNA when I was watching it.
So he was, Voodoo Kin Mafia, you mentioned them. So, of course. Did you ask him about the Alamo, or did you decide, no, I don't want, Mikey already thinks I'm a mark, I better not make Billy Gunn think I am as well.
I don't think I watched the Alamo part yet, but, you know, but he was vaping a lot, so that's what I can say.
I've heard stories of Billy Gunn's seminars, and it's pretty much, he can be really nice to you or you can be the worst human being ever. So it's either or when it comes to Billy Gunn. I suppose he's, and he's humongous. That's one thing I never realized until I met him, and I was like, oh my god, the size of you.
Yeah, he's a big boy.
So 2 months in, you did a Rampage Brown seminar. Michael Chase likes you, or at least likes you enough to take an interest in you.
Yep.
And you eventually, were you refereeing for Reckless before you actually got in the ring, or was it refereeing that you were doing first?
No, actually, I was like wrestling first before the refereeing.
Okay, so do you remember what your first match was, or what you were feeling when you were told you were going to get your first match?
Yeah, my first match was like in the Reckless Summer 2016, which is like literally 1 year after I joined Reckless. So I was like very excited and kind of a little bit nervous, because it was very first time me being on the stage.
I think there was a couple debuts, because I remember I was doing the results, and I end up, I think I mixed up yourself and another wrestler was making a debut around by the time their names, and it was just all over the place, just because it was, I think it was a, oh, his name, Justin Deed, I think his name was.
Yeah.
And I was getting, yeah, his name and your name just all a muddle when I was writing stuff out. So it's a rumble. So it's a little bit less pressure on you, I suppose.
Yep.
So how did you feel you did? Were you just happy to at least get one in, or what was your thoughts on the match itself?
Okay, this is going to be brief because I was literally like 30 seconds in this match.
Right, okay.
Yeah, but I did end up kicking a Oompa Loompa on that spots, to say politely. And then I got eliminated by Jetstream Jack.
That's not a bad way to.
Yeah.
It's weird that if you were speaking to like your family or what have you, and they were like, "Oh, how's your wrestling?" Well, I kicked an Oompa Loompa, and then I got chucked out the ring. That was it.
Yep, so, that was it.
So from that point on, what was your first actual match then? So I mean, Rumble, of course, it's a great learning tool, but you're only in for 30 seconds, and all you really hope for is you don't get yourself tangled in the ropes on the way out. So what was it like actually getting your first proper match?
Oh yeah, my first proper match was like, I was gonna say 2000, like in the shorts, but then I remember it was like not really a proper match. So I'd say my first proper match was like in 2018, which was like with against Rob Mills. And yeah, it was actually was like, I felt like way, way, way more confident because between the time with the Rumble and this match, I was like doing like a lot of refereeing. So it kind of get me more used to being in the ring and sorting out my shyness and anxiety in the ring. And also got me being helping a bit be more a little more vocal as well.
Well, that's the thing. How did you find that those early times in the ring, whether you want to call them matches or not? But so you said that confidence thing, was that something you struggled with? Was it more of being confident, or was there any like, I don't know, language barrier or something that you were trying to get your words out, but they might not be responding as much? How did you overcome that? Because now you're like, just this, you come across as a super confident wrestler. So how did you manage to bridge that gap?
I seriously have no idea how that happened. Like,
maybe it's because you're supposed to be the good guy, maybe. Yeah. And now that you can just tell them they're all smelly, it's...
Yeah, I became far more confident when I was being like, you know, a baddie than the goodie, because it's really, really hard to like try to get people to like you rather than hate you.
Oh yeah,
which I guess why people like to be healed so much.
It's from what I've seen, it's definitely a lot easier, because I suppose with being a bad guy, all you have to do is mock them, but mock a crowd a bit, and then that's it. As a good guy, you've got to be support me, and then a crowd could be like, why?
Yeah.
I know why I hate him. I don't know why I have to like you this as well. So I'm just having a quick look. So you're in the kind of hardcore division. So bits and pieces in 2017 before you, as you say, you feel like you made your proper debut with Rob Mills there as well. So a little bit of tag team stuff as well. So you always had someone nearby. But when you're actually wrestling Rob then, so we're saying I've got 2016's debut. I'm ignoring that. 2018's your debut. So what was it like getting the ring with Rob? Because Rob was... I don't know what 2018, I can't remember his character particularly at that point, but he's a bit more outgoing.
Yeah, I think at this time he was like in headbanders, so it's like more flamboyant-ish.
So what was it like actually like getting your first proper singles match with trying to get a crowd interacting with someone that you're comfortable with because you traveled training with? Did that help?
Yeah, I think this helped a little bit. Even despite the fact that we were both like baby faces in this match, it actually went quite well. And it was actually very enjoyable because we didn't like mess up anything that much. Well, aside from maybe me slipping during the dive, but it happens. But other than that, we were like very, very comfortable with each other. We didn't like... I keep bringing the same things. Sorry about that, but...
That's all right. That comfortableness, obviously, it made it a little bit easier for you to start off with. Yep. So I'm going to your 2018 year. I'm trusting cage match. I know that they're not the most accurate when it comes to results. So if I miss something like amazing that you want to bring up, just tell me and I'll do that. But so 2018, after the hardcore stuff in 2017, you end up coming out with the Reckless Intent UK title.
Yep.
Soon afterwards. Beating Dells and Dare.
Yep.
So as a guy how was it like? Was it like when say hardcore title is different because 24/7, it's everyone gets a go of it, kind of. What was it like actually winning a belt like the UK title?
Yep. So I'm gonna first start with the UK title, not UK, the hardcore title, because the way I won it for the first time was like very interesting, since it was like in a Reckless Rumble 2017. And I somehow end up pinning Mr. Byers for the belt through that Rumble match. And then literally minutes, seconds after that, I got pinned by Mr. News and lost the belt in the same minute, I believe. So yeah, that was like very, very interesting.
The Reckless, I mean, they've got rid of their hardcore title now, but they were always very, very inventive with their hardcore title stuff. There was, of course, backstage at Discovery where there was title changes over the course of a weekend, where some of the biggest names and some of the ones we can't mention anymore, but some of the biggest names won the title, like Doug Williams ended up coming away with it. So you're still, so you could technically say that he won the same title as Doug Williams, and as someone who's big into TNA, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
So win the title, beating Dells and Dare, UK title. Like I said, so what was it like getting that singles belt for the first time, because it's a very nice belt.
Yeah,
if I do say so. Was it just phoning everyone? Did you tell anyone? What was your kind of reaction to getting it?
I'll be honest, I was like very, very surprised that I got the title like this early in my career, especially since I was literally told on the day of the show that I will be basically fighting for the belt. I mean, not the fighting, just getting the belt, because it was basically like very surprising, considering like few months before that I wasn't like properly wrestling. I was just like being a ref, and somehow I ended up being not only in a title match but winning it as well.
It must have shown a little bit of faith in you then. Again, I don't know if it was Michael that was the driving force, because he'd seen your work that you'd put in, but again going through your match here, you end up defending it. Oh, it's your heart, sorry, the hardcore and UK title stuff's getting a little bit mixed up now in my notes. But you ended up facing guys like DCT and Mr. News, of course. I'm a big fan of Mr. News. As always, he's the best wrestler you've never heard of.
Yep.
Of course, you did some stuff with the Headbanders, with Rob. So did you find that 2018 was probably just like such a surprising year for you? Because you started it your first singles match and then winning belts all over the place. How did you feel? Was it just like on top of the world, your 2018?
Yeah, let's say 2018 was like kind of a roller coaster for me, because the first few months of 2018 was like very good, because as I was like finally wrestling properly and winning belts. However, in April, I kind of like had to like vacate my UK title because I got my injury in the wrist. So I wasn't allowed to like properly wrestle for like two months. So that was like kind of a downer for me, but later got picked up in July when I started to like wrestle guys like DCT, which was a very, very, very enjoyable match to say.
So was the wrist injury, was that wrestling related, or was it?
It was wrestling related. During the training, I kind of broke it while taking a suplex.
I'm trying to work out the physics of that. So was it just how you landed, or
it was like the front suplex, and instead of like and kind of like bending that way, that's how I landed pretty much on the head. And let's say I was pretty out from like 2 months.
I know from my own experience, bone breakings, it can just be, and it's the weirdest thing. So because if if you had your wrist any straighter, it would have broken something else further up. And if that was any straighter, because it's a boring story for everyone that's ever heard it from me, but I broke my elbow and in three places, absolutely demolished the thing. And I was told pretty much I landed like that, but I landed with my arm like that. So the shock went up here and like that. So if you're doing it like that, it's going up and out. It's weird. It's such a weird thing. And it's, broken bones are not fun for anyone. So when you had that and you said you're out for 2 months, was there any trepidation about coming back and nerves that you may be able to, that you may re-injure it? Was you a little bit, were you more careful than you usually would be when you came back from the wrist injury?
I was like actually fine with the injury. However, I wasn't like too much fine in my mentally. And let us say like the last few months of 2018 weren't the greatest for me. So I decided to like took a small break after a discovery show with the zombies and stuff. I decided to like took a small break from wrestling and later come back when I feel like more okay in my head and basically much more better wrist-wise as well.
I mean, at least I like it. I'd rather have wrestlers take a break when they feel they need to, because I mean, I suppose in the old days, wrestlers would have just wrestled through everything. Mm-hmm. But I suppose, though you enjoy doing wrestling, it's not your full-time job. It's not your life. So the fact that you're able to recognize going, right, something's not making me happy, mm-hmm. I'll just come away from this for a bit and just reset myself something. If it needs to be done, it needs to be done. And I don't think anyone would look at you and go, well, how dare you? Because it's wrestling at the end of the day. It's not real. It hurts, but it's not real. So the Discovery show then, that's mm-hmm. that's a good way to get onto that. Mm-hmm. The zombies, that was weird.
Yeah, that was weird.
Were you one of the zombies or were you just involved? Were you refereeing that show?
Yeah, I was like a referee for just this much alone.
Okay. Yeah.
I got like special order from Alan to just referee this match because it's me. Yeah, that was like one of the weirdest matches I ever had to ref or see for that matter.
Yeah. I've only ever seen the footage back. I can't imagine what it'd be like just there because it's just the weirdest thing. And I know WWE did it not long ago or tried to do it not long ago. And it was, odd to see it. So it came to refereeing then, and we'll switch that a little bit. Mm-hmm. Because Cage Match doesn't list referees, I have no idea what matches you refereed. So the Zombie Lumberjack match being one of them. That's with Sugar Dunkerton and Gene Money. So mm-hmm. two very experienced guys to referee. Any particular favourite matches that you were able to get in the middle of that had some moments or just ones that you're very proud of to be in the stripes for?
Mm. Yeah, I would say like the matches between like Jim, I think I referee in total like two matches between Sugar and Gene Money, because like the series of their matches is like very, very interesting, especially after the second show where Gene Money, now known as a Mother Taker, decided to like steal the soul of Sugar after the match. And it was like, I felt like the match with Zombies was weird, but this just got weirder and weirder. And I was like trying to so hard to like not to laugh in front of everyone. But it was very challenging.
Yeah. So you were there for the date was you were there for the debut of the Undertaker then when he came out in the big trench coat and the ill-fitting hat and that and you were just having to stare or was the match itself that you were...
I mean not the debut, but like the rematch of that match. From the Zombies Lumberjack match,
right? So that was the it's just anyone who is listening or watching this, just go and seek them out because it's. I don't think words can ever do justice to those matches because they're just weird, and it's wrestling. It's the best kind. Mm-hmm. It's just stupid. Yeah. that's the best bit about wrestling. So you took your break and you reset yourself mm-hmm. a little bit. So
yeah.
Did you find that you were just, did you put wrestling on the back burner entirely? Did you stop watching it, trying to get just have that removed? Or were you just keeping up with this stuff that's going on at Reckless in the UK and WWE, AEW? What was your kind of wrestling habit during that time?
Yeah, I was trying to like keep up with wrestling like a little bit, but not like too much, just to not get, you know, too stressed out mentally again. But in the end, it wasn't as bad as I thought it was. And I managed to get back to training like in, I think, December, last few weeks of December of that year. And by the same time, I also noticed that there are like new food people arriving from other school, specifically like people like Grom, Steven Miles, and Alex Webb. And yeah, there were like pretty much a few changes that happened while I was gone for like a month.
Yeah, a lot of the Dundee guys jumped over and were starting there. And of course, it was Michael Chase. Of course, he retired the year after, 2019.
Yeah,
you were able to get in the ring with them before that. Was that year? What was it like actually getting in the ring with them? We're gonna jump about the timeline a bit because I've got notes written down and
To be fair, it was like still in 2018, I believe.
Okay.
I had like one-on-one match with Michael Chase, like literally one day after I won the UK Championship. And that was like on the birthday party as well. So.
All right. Okay. Oh, yeah. I did reach on a bit of a cake, but I think that was Discovery Wrestling.
Yeah. That's like 1 year later.
Right, we'll get into that then. We'll get into that in a minute. But we'll concentrate where we are in 2018. So get in the ring with Michael, Michael Chase. So he was the guy who didn't like you, liked you, pushed you, mentored you.
Yep.
What was it like actually wrestling him?
First, I was like very scared because, you know, it's Michael Chase and he's like, but he can be very, very, it's very hard when he like messed something up or, you know, try to not doing something too good in a match. However, shockingly, I saw how I ended up doing not too badly in this match. And Michael actually managed to praise me after this match and saying he was like one of the better matches he had with trainees. Although I believe that's my later change when he had wrestled other trainees, but yep, still something.
At the time, you just, again, along with being the best Polish wrestler, you're also was his best match with a trainee. So, you know, this CV is growing along with your title wins. So you had that match, and I'll have a look through. So there's a few matches here and there with the odd squad, into 2019. When did you just, I don't have a note when you eventually became a bad guy, but what was your thoughts on transferring yourself from being the babyface to just embracing the dark side, and was it the chief of staff run? What was the catalyst for you turning rogue?
I had a catalyst. Yeah, pretty much getting like tried to be like as you said, being like the chief of staff and being like more powerful than any other wrestlers, but it kind of doesn't translate too well as an actual wrestling as. As you can see by my win and loss record, it's not the greatest since I became a chief of staff.
Yeah, it was going through your 2019 Facebook was a lot of I've lost again.
Yep.
But again, you got a win over Soldato, so you know that counts for something.
That's something.
But no, you got a couple matches in with like Theodorus, of course, who we trained with him as well.
Yeah.
He would have been another guy that would have come over to Scotland and started wrestling. So I don't know if you had a kind of kinship with him a little bit. When it comes to wrestling, though, Chris, we've talked about Discovery. You're referring in that weird match, the Zombie Lumberjack. Mm-hmm. I've got you noted here as you made your debut in 2020 with the Reckless Raffle.
Mm-hmm.
So did you feel that was a big moment that you've kind of graduated from refereeing it shows a Discovery to actually being on one of their shows? What was it like actually getting to wrestle for Discovery Wrestling?
I actually felt very excited because I think during this time I was actually feeling way, way, way more confident than before. And I think it was even noticeable by other people from Discovery as well. And I was also surprised that actually very many people in the audience actually end up liking me in the end, so that's something as well. Although in the end I end up being like destroyed by Deacon Matthews. But hey, at least I got my one and only elimination in the Rumble match, so there's still something.
Yeah, Discovery, from what I've seen, is a very fun crowd. You could be the bad guy, but if you're gosh darn entertaining, they're gonna love you anyway. It's a quite nice way of doing it. So did you find that your run being the heel, being the bad guy, chief of staff, that boosted your confidence because you're able to go out and I don't know, like we were saying, you're able to call the crowd whatever you want and they'll just take it as part of the entertainment. Yeah. Did you find that was what helped boost your confidence?
Yeah, it helped me boost the confidence a little bit, especially since I had like my boss Kieran and Grum with me at the time, and they also helped me boost a little bit of confidence outside as well.
And you also had your debut in Source as well that year, 2020, in one of their Battle Royal, but I thought it was just an elimination match, triple elimination match.
Match was like, do you know like SmackDown versus Raw games where I had like Battle Royals, and there was option for like doing like pin, submission, and elimination over the top rope.
Right, I'm with you.
Yeah, that's pretty much like this match as well.
So again, that's another crowd, and as you said, you're feeling your confidence. Is you've got your crowd with you. You're gaining confidence as each match goes, and then you're thrown into Source, which is again a different. A lot there will be a little bit of crossover with the audience, but not too much.
Yeah.
Did you find that? What was it like trying to get another crowd to react? Yeah, an outsider crowd, because of course with Reckless you would have been there every month and the crowd will know you, but you're going into Source and not many people would. Was it just because of all that confidence you were able to kind of put your character across a little bit? Were you able to get them to react how you wanted to? What was that experience like?
Yeah, it was like very, at first I thought it was going to be very difficult to try to like get to booby during my Source debut, but surprisingly, I ended up getting booed pretty much during this match, especially during the spots with Xero when he tried to scare me and attack me, and I kind of outsmarted him. And also, they booed like a lot of when I end up there, the dance break, saying that the dancing is forbidden in the show, and end up pretty much booting Freddy the Fanboy. It was like the highlight of my Source career.
So between booting Freddy the Fanboy and kicking him in Palumpa, it's like just like beating people that are just smaller. It's a good way to get you booed, and clearly it's worked. So outside of that, I was having like just I was curious to see if there's any other Polish wrestlers that have turned up like in like the WWE and that. Of course, outside of Crowbar, I don't know if you've got an ongoing rivalry with, if he knows about it, to be the best Polish wrestler in Scotland. But what I was surprised to see was Commander Aziz.
Yeah.
So Baba Tunde, he was known for, I think that's what his name is, actually. When you see a Polish wrestler in WWE, do you feel like that's like, I know he's very much different to yourself in build and height and just everything, but is that kind of something that seems to be a realistic goal that you could see? Right, they've got a guy from Poland wrestling in WWE. That's something I could possibly do now. Do that.
Yeah, I think that's like a realistic goal I can try to go for, and hopefully in the future maybe end up being like in WWE or something, or like any other popular company, but I don't know. I can't predict the future, so
nothing. If we've learned anything in the last few years, nothing is impossible when it comes to wrestling.
Yep.
I was going to say during lockdown, all these pandemic things, 2020 happened. Made a debut in Discovery, then pretty much that was it. Yeah. That was all the wrestling for the foreseeable. You end up, you kind of had a bit of a social media kind of break. I don't know if that was for whatever reason, and then when you eventually did pop back up, you were ripped.
Yep.
So what happened? How did you end up going from how did you, that body transformation? What was the how did that happen?
Steroids. No, but for real now. I think during like the end of 2020, I look when after like few weeks of training during the time when we allowed to train, I've noticed that my body and my cardio wasn't as great as it used to be. I mean, not that it was great in the first place, but it was manageable. But after the first lockdown, I got way, way, way more obese and not healthy in the first place. So I decided to get called with Theo Torres, whose side job is like being a PT and nutritious as well. I asked him to like join his program. So, and from like I believe December, I started like doing his program with like the diet and exercises and stuff, which is also challenging during the second lockdown where the gyms were locked and I had to train at home and outside as well.
What was the hardest thing? Was it just adjusting your diet, or what did you find was the biggest hurdle in getting through that program?
Yeah, I think trying to get like 1800 calories of cardio during the week, I was especially during the lockdown, and I ended up like running way, way a lot, and I ended up getting like a lot of blisters on my feet, and yeah, that wasn't a great time, but.
Even with
the like limited diet and stuff, surprisingly diet was like the worst part of it. So that's positive.
I remember during the lockdown, maybe like the first one, I decided to do walking. And I whatever you lost, I found. It seems to be during lockdown. But yeah, the blisters. It was the first time where I've actually invested in, like, I was looking up Skechers and I was looking up everything, because this is not going to sound a lot to a lot of people, but I ended up doing like a 15-mile walk. My dog hated it. I think I almost had to drag her home because she was just done. And yeah, I was like, first thing as soon as I got home, Skechers. Socks that are padded. I was dead. I'm dying now. So yeah, it's feet health is important for anyone. If you take away any lesson from this podcast, listeners, just watch your feet. running, that seems to be your...
Yeah. Hopefully post doesn't listen to that podcast.
So we got running and cardio, and you made your in-ring debut last night as of recording.
Yeah, yesterday.
Yes, yeah, and unfortunately, you didn't win. I only got the results like 20 minutes before we chatted. So I now know that information. What was it like actually finding out that shows were coming back and that you were going to be in a match? And did you feel you were ring ready? Did you get any? How much were you training beforehand in a ring before you were able to actually make your return?
Yeah, I think I was like training like before the shows were announced for like for a couple of months or more. Yeah, pretty much like once we like the training, the wrestling was like back on, I was like training for most of the days when I was allowed to. And I was like pretty much like more in ready I was today than I was in like in the past. Yeah, I basically feel like way, way more confident than before. I didn't feel like not as nervous as I used to as well. So yeah, there's like a little more and more progress is happening during my life and career.
And did you find what was the bit that you kind of forgot about when you went back in the ring for the first time? Was it just the ropes, or as soon as you hit the ground on your back, you're like, oh, I forgot how sore this was? Was there any bits that you were like, you forgot how hard or as painful as it was until you actually did it again?
Yeah, pretty much forgot how hard the chops can be.
You got less to pad now.
Yeah, it also doesn't help that I stopped wearing my bodysuit and I now wrestle with the tights again to basically show my physique.
course. If you've got it, you got to flaunt it. So, did you find the bodysuits? I don't know. Did that help with your confidence? Because you weren't, if you weren't as confident in your body beforehand, that was all covered up, and you were able to not show it. And then now that you've actually, like I say, you're ripped and you're in great shape again. You're able to just show off proudly. Was there a reason why you did the bodysuit, or was you a big fan of MVP?
Yeah, that's pretty much like there was a running joke that was like, keep wearing like turtleneck sweaters in a training for one day, and they wanted me to have like a wrestling gig, like either Goldust or MVP, where but with like a higher turtleneck. So I went with that, and it also helped me with the physique, because again, my physique wasn't the greatest at the time because I was like very skinny and stuff. So that kind of helped hide it a little bit better.
Mm. Yeah. You see some wrestlers that haven't got the best physiques and they insist on wearing tights, and you're like, get singlet. Yeah. Just make it look all so much better. And it's not a body shaming thing. It's just it looks more comfortable if you're like, if it's there, if it's like, if it's nothing's flapping out. And I say that as a fat man. I know I'd be more comfortable with a singlet than over a bodysuit over tights if I had the body like this. So right, I'm just gonna get into my stupid questions, because we asked two silly questions to every guest.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've listened to any past recordings or anything with anyone, because I've done some interviews with, like, Deacon Matthews and Alex Webb, but we ask everyone the same ones. First one is, what's your favorite dinosaur?
My favorite dinosaur. Does it have to be like a real dinosaur, or?
Not at all. It can be as tenuously related to dinosaurs as you want. So go for it.
Okay, so I'll go with Stegosaurus from Robot Wars.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
I forgot about the dinosaurs in Robot Wars.
Yep.
Matilda. Oh yeah. Man, I did a list of 100 dinosaurs, and it took me ages. And now that you've given me Robot Wars, as and now my list is all gone to pot. So I need to get Matilda in there at least, and Sergeant Bash, and all those classic. I think Sergeant Bash was a dinosaur, but yeah. Well, that's my evening. That's sort of. So the other question we ask everyone: what would win a fight, two sheep or one cow?
That's an interesting question. Two sheep, or I don't know, probably like one cow, because I don't think sheep would be the bothered attacking the cow in the first place, but what can I know about animals?
It's fine. It's a ridiculous question anyway. Either people put way too much thought into it, or just throw out an answer, and that's either way, I don't care. It's just a weird, it's just a funny question that we ask. Thanks to Liu Kang Sharp and Krieger. Sure. That's how it kind of ended up kicking off.
Amazing.
So like I say, I did start with a going through everything, and I'm now just throwing out questions on the fly. When it comes to your future, then, you said that, because we mentioned Commander Aziz and Babatunde, and that it's not impossible to be in the WWE regardless of where you're from, or it is a global thing now. Is that kind of your goal? Is it WWE, or just a major promotion? Do you have like an end game goal in mind?
Yeah, pretty much my end game goal is like try to be like in a like more mainstream promotion, like not necessarily like WWE level, but like somewhere like I like get more and more notoriety throughout the years and years, so I can kind of help boost my career and my wrestling as well.
So when it comes to, like you said, like more mainstream promotions, I don't know how much you watch. Do you watch things like Japan? Would that be something you'd want to get to? Like I said, AEW mentioned Impact. Mm-hmm. I suppose Impact would be perfect, because, you know, that's how you started watching wrestling, was through TNA.
Pretty much.
And is there any UK promotions that you'd want to get involved with, like an ICW Progress? Again, that would boost the notoriety because it's on the WWE Network. Is there anywhere that you're kind of wanting to get to?
Yeah, I think ICW would like a good idea to be my next goal, to like try to like wrestle for them, because I was like, a lot of my friends like Dicky Divers, Jack Morris, and Theodorus are big on this show, and I hope to like get to their footsteps as well, being on the network as well. But you never know.
And is there any wrestlers that you want to get in the ring with in the next, I don't know, let's say, well, now you're back in the ring, you're wrestling again. Is there, say, next 5 years, is there any particular wrestlers in the UK or anywhere that you want to get in the ring with?
This is a tough one because I haven't given myself like much of a thought about it.
You just want to get back in the ring first and then just take it from there.
Pretty much, yeah.
So, I mean, because Reckless, of course, because of guys like Dickie Divers and Aspen Faith and all that, they're kind of bringing in a lot of, I mean, Stevie Boy was just on a show yesterday. These are big names in the UK, and BT Gunn and what have you. So you're just happy just to be wrestling. The opponents isn't as important at this stage, or is there, again, anyone that you think I want to get the ring with them, be it a Divers or what have you.
Yeah, anyone I can like get like more experience in the matches, and pretty much, yeah.
That's fair. So outside of wrestling, what's your passions? What's your joys? For me, it's Marvel films. That's about it, to be honest. But is there any outside wrestling passions that may surprise our listeners, viewers here for the wrestling chat?
Yeah, also, like I mentioned, like during the dinosaur questions, like I like a lot of robots wars and stuff. Like more specifically, like there's like also the American Robot Battle Federation called BattleBots, which is I also really enjoy because robots there are like very, very extreme and like basically like making like a massacre of robots, to say the least.
Okay. My experience at Robot Wars, I think it was a lot younger. Hypno Disc and Chaos 2, all that kind of stuff. I love Chaos.
My favorite.
Panic Attack was the other. Was that Panic Attack? It was the yellow one, and Chaos 2 just kept flipping it, and it was a self writer. Just kept going.
I think it was Panic Attack.
I've got so many. Mortis. That was that stupid one. That was.
Yep.
Furry, and it got set on fire. Yeah, that was
Mortis.
It's Mortis.
No, because I believe Mortis was just like the one with the $3,000 blade attached to it that barely do anything damage. I think the robot was set on fire. There was like Nemesis or Deotera was no later.
Mortis. Yeah, okay. Yeah, they took it off and it was still just as useless. It just what am I thinking of then? Hang on, right.
I think it was Nemesis. Don't look like strawberry.
I'm gonna find this out now. Okay, so Nemesis. That's it. Yes.
Yeah.
Hated it.
I know my. I liked it.
Oh, I've just now Googled Nemesis. There's some terrible robots on here that I remember.
Yeah, the
Firestorm. I loved Firestorm.
Yeah. My favorite worst robot from Robot Wars was like Psycho Sprout. Just Google it and look how it looks. So.
I'll do that now. So Psycho Sprout. So while I'm doing this, what was your favorite? You mentioned the Stegosaurus, but what was your other favorite house robots?
Yeah, definitely Circle a lot.
Oh yeah. Oh, I'm looking at Psycho Sprout now.
Yeah, that robot was basically like a RC car put inside a dome, and there was like basically driving around it from. I'm surprised that they like they've passed the first stage.
Oh yeah, I've seen that. Yeah, that's terrible. How? All right, now just electric motor. Of course it is because it's such an RC car inside. Yeah. Turn in circle zero. It is a circle. Oh man, this has unlocked a lot of memories for me. Yep. Outside of updating my dinosaur list, I'm going to be just looking at robots.
Yep.
Robot Wars.
Yeah, the first two seasons were like very underwhelming, to say the least. Because I felt like in the past it was like very, very, you know, robots were like hitting harder, but in the end, when I look at it back, they like barely do any damage. It's like basically hitting like a piece of metal with a toothpick. Even the house robots were like not the greatest at the time.
Oh yeah, I like Matilda, but it was I don't know how we can describe Matilda other than in Monsters Inc. And they've got what's her name in Monsters Inc. Oh, the woman that's actually in. I'm gonna remember it, and I'm not gonna remember it. I'm just gonna Google it instead. Did voice cast? Let's see. This is amazing for anyone that's listening and watching me trying to Roz. I don't know why Matilda always reminds me of just Roz. Just the slow moving thing that just all chunky and what have you. So yeah, so Cool Lot. Anyway, so Cool Lot was amazing.
Yep.
I like Sergeant Bash because he had the floor. That was.
And I think also like Matilda, but from season 5 and up, because she got like upgraded weapon instead of doing like having the chainsaw, which was like very useless against metal robots. She had like a spinning disc with like bits of coming out, so that could deal like a lot of damage. And yeah, she caused like quite a lot of mayhem as well.
I hated the ref bot. I hated it. I think I remember one time that two robots ended up pushing Refbot into the pit, which was the best day ever when I was younger. So you enjoy robot wars and robot battling. Have you ever created your own?
Nah, I'm too stupid for that.
I mean, we've seen Psycho Sprout. It's not impossible.
Yeah, fair enough. I don't think I did consider it because I saw on YouTube a UK robot league called Bugglebots, which is like a 5 kilo robots fighting against each other, and also features like competitors from like BattleBots as well. But I don't know, maybe I'll think about it in the future.
If you were to create one, what would you call it?
That's a tough one as well. I'll probably call it Pole Position.
Oh, nice. I love a pun. That's even better.
Yeah.
But so you have to go in with a bit of confidence then, because you can't give it a rubbish weapon if it's called Pole Position, because you have to win now. Would it be a flipper, because you like chaos too? Yeah. Or would you
definitely
go for
a flipper?
Yeah, okay, that's fine. I was gonna say, or do you want the spinning disc? All of them, just everything. Why not?
Yeah, just so it can make a weight limit.
Of course, yeah.
Because there's like many, many weight divisions.
So it's not like it's not the X division. It's not about weight limits. It's about no limits.
Yeah.
So we've mentioned like you just want to get back to wrestling, but and you said your end game is get a promotion that you'll be able to make a name for yourself and get some notoriety. When it came to favorite wrestlers, you mentioned the TNA guys near the start of our chat here. But was there anyone that's still actively going anywhere in the world that you'd want to get in the ring with to wrestle? So this is fantasy booking, main event of WrestleMania. You get to choose your opponent. Who would it be?
I think I'll go with Cesaro, because again, it's like me, he's like a foreign wrestler, and the way that he managed to like get himself to like a very, very high level, it's very impressive and inspirational for very other countries as well. And I hope, like, in the future, I manage to like be just as on the same level as him as well. And yeah, pretty much, I enjoy watching Cesaro matches as well.
Is he one of your favorites right now, or is there anyone else that you watch and in particular, either to get some inspiration for your own work? I feel when I see like videos of you and that, I see a lot of like a Sami Zayn, the conspiracy theory Sami Zayn kind of thing. He's a bit crazier, but he backs it up in the ring. Is there anyone else in particular that you'd like watching, either I said for training or ideas, or just to enjoy watching them wrestle?
Yeah, I just enjoy watching them wrestle overall, but more specifically because like specific wrestlers, I would say like guys like Sami Zayn, Tyson Kidd, a little bit of like World of Sports stuff, just so I can get like some moves that haven't been done before. And more specifically, Dobby's choice, old WCW.
Okay.
Specifically Russo era.
A little bit of Norman Smiley and all that kind of thing.
Ralphus.
Oh, Ralphus. Wow. There's a that's yeah, that's certainly something came to it. That's the weirdest way to wrap up an interview, go Ralphus, yep. And then go, right, that's fine, let's get out of here. Yep. We've covered everything.
Covered the cake stuff.
Oh, cakes. Ah, great. Right. Thank you for reminding me of that. So when I was going through your Facebook, and you kind of do every so often, every 6 months or so, you end up doing a bullet point of what happened in your year or months or wrap up. Mm-hmm. And you mentioned dropping a cake.
Yeah.
So how, when, what, why, just the whole thing.
Okay. So it was like a Discovery Year 5 show. And I was given the task to give the birthday cake for Simon Miller at the table, like before he comes in and with the 99 and stuff. So everything was going fine. And the second was coming in and I decided to like grab the cake and put it on the middle of the ring. However, instead of like picking like cake normally, I picked the cake with the stool as well. So I was holding the stool with the cake, balancing in the middle. And everything was going okay until I lift the cake stool up and the cake fell to the canvas. The cake's the chocolate side down. So the entire canvas was covered with chocolate. And I saw people like Rob Mills looking at me, like trying to hold up his laughter and stuff. And it didn't help that I decided to like use the brush, which just ended up getting worse as I spread more and more chocolate from the canvas. Finally, Rob was like, after like crying from laughter for like a minute, decided to give me like blue row, and I managed to get most of the chocolate out. And I was like basically like being off red face throughout the show. And it didn't help that Simon Cassidy said, "You literally had one job at me." I was like very, very embarrassed. And then the segment came off, and luckily Simon didn't notice it. However, Divers notices that he just look at me and laughed as well. That was like, for some people, that was like the best part of the show. But for me, it was like probably one of the most embarrassing moments in my, the life as well.
It's just when you say chocolate cake, because like if there's any big mark you don't want in a wrestling ring is a big brown mark, and that's just like, I mean, thankfully the Discovery rings, if I remember rightly, they've kind of got a black canvas anyway, or gray or that, so it's not as noticeable, but oh man, that's wow. So what happened to the cake after that? Was it just destroyed, or was there a backup cake?
I think I still used the same cake was used for the segment. Yeah, but pretty much it ended up being, but I think still being end up as a, you know, being thrown at Simon's face by looking sharp. So I think it was like any difference from it.
What was the reaction from like Alan and that when you went back, and or were you just avoiding eye contact with everyone?
First I was sold by like all the reckless guys in the who was doing like a ring crew for the show, and they were like laughing to the fact that I dropped the cake. Then also came like, I think Randy Valentine, the commentator, he was also like broke out of laughing when he saw that cake and tried to hold himself. And then I went to like Alan to apologize for the fact that I dropped the cake, but thankfully he wasn't that mad at me. And because I'll be honest, I was like very scared that he was not gonna like to either book me or make me the ref again. But thankfully, after that, he didn't mind that cake stuff, and I still end up being like the ref after this show, and later end up being a wrestler as well.
Maybe it was like, we can't trust him doing the referee and stuff. If he's got to do props, we'll just make him a wrestler instead. That's probably the safest way now. We'll just have him wrestling. So. Yeah, that's a perfect way to wrap up. Let's go with that. Thank you for joining me, Dave. Before we go, though, you've got to plug all your social media. I noticed you've got merch now. Plug everything. Where can people find you and buy your stuff?
Okay, they can find me at the Twitter and Instagram under Jarek_Nowak. The Facebook under, I think it's Jarek Nowak as well, but I'm not sure. I was on Facebook for a while. And you can also buy my Copa Bear shirt as well on a I think it was like UK tees or something, but yeah, you can get them for like a cheap price of like, I think it's like 15 quid or something, but
go for it. Yeah. So thank you for not correcting me. I was looking at your name and I was looking going, Jarek Nowak, and I thought that was it. So it's Novak. I'll know that for the future. Mm-hmm. Perfect. Well, thank you very much for speaking today. I thank you for reminding me about the cake story because I would have felt absolutely terrible if that went out in another interview and I didn't ask about it, or at least didn't know about it. But yeah, thanks for joining me today on the show.
Yeah, thank you as well for having me.